Man, it's hard to put into words. It's like, you know, a lifelong dream. And it started with the guy that's doing this interview with me, watching his videos, man. Like, you know, you watch what's going on over here in California. You don't really know, you know, a whole lot where I was at. And you see how this deal plays out, and then you finally make it. And it's a dream come true. I can't ask for any more.
But it's just amazing to be here with all the icons that I looked up to when I was living in Australia, and pat myself on the back. It's something I'm pretty proud of, you know, to be here running top field at the March meet. Not many people in the world get the opportunity to do this.
Been racing front motor top fuel or front engine top fuel since 92 here. You know, this March meet is it's like our biggest race of the year. This is the one that everybody comes to go, and this is the one that you want to win.
It's really just kind of the king of the class, the king of the sport. It's a grassroots beer league class, and that's just fit our program.
Started many years ago with Garland and the whole crew, and the way this thing was, it was the Woodstock of drag racing early on, and it's just the special race. It's the race you want to go to. It's the race you want to win. You know, for the Indy 500, that would be, you know, run around cars. That's what they'd want to win. This is what a drag racer wants to win. And it's carried on with this, you know, with the front engine top fuel dragsters. When they came back, they kind of took over Bakersfield, and it's our race, it's our one that we want to win.
Yeah, we're definitely trying some stuff and trying to get the compression right and everything. We just think we're just a little high on that, and change a few little things on the car, try to make it a little bit better, but it's got potential. We're not used to running this type of weather, for one. We're Midwest guys, and you know, we deal a lot of humidity, and it's dry air out here, and we just need laps.
Here we go.
Let's
We're going to find
out. Out of that violator car, Donnie. Here comes Murphy in a cloud of smoke. 5-8-3-8. Sean Mone at 205. Murphy at 616. 190.
A single run over here in top fuel, Mike.
Shane Stewart, Jeremy Sullivan, another guy who wheeled the fuel altar. Remember, he drove that bad news car.
Yeah.
That little incident into the sand, you know, we bent the axle just a little bit, so I remade a new axle for it, you know, do all the wheel alignment and all that sort of stuff. But in the off-season, having that accident gave us an opportunity to go completely through the car again, look at the frame, look at the welds. Also, that run showed us that we do make a lot of power. We've got good mile an hour. We just decided to get more aggressive with it a little bit earlier, you know, and then we can always bring the power to it again later, given it ran 258. So we just looked at our tune-ups and just tweaked it here or there, and you know, we'll see what we can do today in Q1. You know, see if our changes have really, you know, worked for us.
Maui! Man, that was on a good run there. And Donnie, you and I watching it up here, Shane got over near the center line there, and I believe the tires started spinning. And when the RPM comes up there, it kind of overloads the cylinder with nitro, and
bam.
You heard it. Bang.
Yeah.
Tyler Hester, the overtime special. Of course, this car is a two-time California Hot Rod Reunion Top Fuel Champion with Daryl Tedford, Rick McGee. Rick, the former driver. Frank McVee Jr., the Valley Thunder team out of Madera. Of course, Garrett Schutz, the crew chief on that car while the Shorty's fabrication. A very small tire on the back of these cars. Down there, but here comes Frank McVee. Tyler goes 5.893, 218. That sounds like a bango down there, Donnie. Of course, far side over there, the H&H Nomad for John and Roxy Herzig. Brian, California Hot Rod Community here, had one heck of a fire down there, top end of that car.
Yeah, he did. I seen his fire suit, it was ugly.
And Brent Williamson. For Mike Fuller and the team, you know, they came into the California Hot Rod Reunion last year with the points lead and just had a horrible weekend. The drivers will come forward. Both of them like that second light. Everyone's moving around down there. Brian Hall, 602, 242. Brent Williamson, 622, 193. They have sacrificed something to God's.
There's brand for mosquitoes down there.
I don't think that's a problem today. Yeah. Brian Hall to the number four spot with that 602. Dan Horan Jr. gets back behind the wheel of the top fuel car. Remember, V. Kaiser drove it at the California Hot Rod Reunion.
Yes,
ran
he did.
For the trophy. Of course, far side, that three-way Chevrolet lane, the circuit breaker. Sports some new colors there, Donnie. Pete Whitburn, former national champion on that car.
You know, you can beat yourself here as easy as you can be beat by someone else. So I just play my own game, you know, keep it, try to just listen to the car and listen to the track and move forward.
They are free stage. Whitburn goes in, Horan goes in. Now that red light starts trucking down there, top. Wow. 582, 227 feet. Whitburn shut it off. 584, 217. Dan Horan shut it off. Pete Whitburn goes to the number one spot. Dan Horan goes to the number two spot. Pete Whitburn was 205 miles an hour in half track. Brandon Murray has probably been doing this longer than anybody in the top fuel field, man. Out of San Jose for racecarparts.com. And
beautiful full body car.
A very period correct car.
Yes.
It's just that this is a new car and an old wrapper. They're all about the same once you take off all of the body and pretty paint and whatnot. I build hot rods and do custom paint, so I'm kind of obligated to have a nice car. But trust me, it was nice to have a short bodied business coupe for a long time, and it was very successful.
Michael Anderson in from Texas.
Yep.
His first ever appearance at the Good Vibrations Motorsports March Meet. Bridges in, waiting on Michael Anderson, like that second light over there at that three-way Chevrolet lane. Brendan moving around down there. Hang on, Brendan. 610, 195, Brendan Murray. 610, 195, Michael Anderson. It's 646, and I'll tell you, that Texas car, he pedaled it once, got down there, and then all of a sudden that made a little dart. So we're at him, a multi-time champion in Top Fuel Eliminator. We'll come up here in the Monkey Little Vulture CP Gorilla Lane.
That little Chevrolet sounds loaded for bear, Mike.
Boy, it does. It's dusty green. Rick Shogart says, come on, boys, let's go. Adam is pre-stage. Dusty bumps it up there. Dusty out the throttle, 630, 193. And I'll tell you, that champion car got out there, Donnie. It started to make a nice move, and then it just kind of like, you being a crew chief, it sounded lazy there.
Look who's up next, Tyler Hill.
Won the California Hot Rod Reunion and the championship. Bill Rosowski over there, that small block Chevrolet, all on champion speed shop. On there, Tyler, 631, 157. That baby had checked out. He was 206 miles an hour at half track. 258.8 to the 330, which is just Twilight Zone numbers.
You know, I only got 6-7 runs in this car, period. It's a very, very fast race car. Like, this car is not a joke. It made a little move, and it's the first run I've had since last fall, and it didn't feel right, and I clicked it, you know? You can always come back and make another lap. I just wasn't comfortable in it. Sometimes it's harder to shut them off than to stay with them, but I shut it off, you know? So incrementally, the car, the motor's fine. It was on a good run. It was on a high 60 type of run, you know? We're going to make some adjustments in the car, how I sit in it and some small stuff like that, and look at some things here while we got the time this afternoon. But I think we'll be okay. Just a little hiccup from first run after being off all winter. So.
First few runs we made with this car, I was overdriving the car, and so I kind of relaxed in the car and kind of let the car tell me what it wants to do, and it's really starting to pay off now. We've got 5 runs on this car since we completely redid it. It's our engine combination and whatnot, and 5 runs in, you know, that's 590 on a 1,000-foot shutoff. We're number 5 right now, so we're looking to improve tomorrow for sure.
Yeah, it's definitely going to take more than that. I lifted a little early, clicked it right about 1,000 foot, so hopefully it's got a little bit more in it. We'll just keep tickling it. Motor seems to be happy, so I think we're headed in the right direction.
You know, Pete Kaiser tunes that car, he puts his heart and soul in that thing, and it is just probably the fastest car in the country. It just gets with it, and I'll tell you, it was a little humbling yesterday. I stepped on it, stepped off it, stepped back on it, and short shifted it, and did everything I could do, but not to make a run, and it still came up number 3, so that thing's a hot rod. You know, the kid does really, really, really good, and I couldn't be happier watching him drive. It's stressful. I don't know how John Force did it and not had a heart attack. I feel like I'm just coming out of my, I feel like my heart's coming out of my chest, but you know what, at the end of the day, he does one hell of a good job. I'm a little behind on the tune-up, and we're gonna tune it up for him and see how we do today.
On that flip-flipping, you're gonna spill it.
They're the coolest cars. I've driven everything. They're most exciting. They go from center line to guardrail every run. You can't see, you got oil in your face, fire, whatever. They're just bitching. That's really the only reason why I wanted one of these things. Looking forward to going A to B this afternoon. We'll see how it goes. Should be a lot better, and then sneak up on it from there. The car's definitely got the potential. It's ran 70s before, and hopefully we'll have it running 70s again here pretty quick.
We're going right now, buddy. let's see, what am I thinking about? Right now, a whole lot. Just hoping that it goes down clean, that we don't have to do a whole bunch of work after this. We're trying to make another round tonight. And yeah, just hoping it goes down clean and smooth. I'm not really too concerned with what it runs. Don't get me wrong, I'd like to get in the show. But we've been having, you know, after that big fire at the reunion, I thought I was gonna be a little gun shy maybe yesterday, and I wasn't. I took it to the stripe, so just hoping what I did worked. And we think we found out what it was, and we're about to find out.
Session number two is Top Fuel Eliminator qualifying session number two up on the board. 6-16 the buff spot for that 8-car field to run for the championship tomorrow and that coveted March Bay trophy. Frank the D Jr., the team in from Madera. He over there got three-way Chevrolet lanes into the number five spot. 28-year-old Farmer right side to 41-year-old Machinist left side. It's Top Fuel Eliminator. Watch that scoreboard. 5-8-7-4 improves to Tyler Hester. 5-8-7-4, 221 miles an hour. Tyler stays number four. Frank McBee, 5-9-3-0, running down their top end, 236 miles an hour, stays in that number five spot. Ryan Hall, former Fuel Altar champion. Dan Horan, former Funny Car champion. Brian's wife, Kelly, backing up her husband, the H&H Snowman, with John and Rocky Hurston. So Kelly Hall bringing her husband in here. Dan Horan, Pete Kaiser making an adjustment on the car. Let me tell you something about that Kelly Hall. Man, that young lady, she is very heavily involved in this car. You go back to that H&H Nomad pit area there. She's in there working just right alongside the guys. And Brian comes back here. Brian Hall deep stage. That affects a lap time. Around their top end. Wow, 5-9-0-6. Brian Hall was 74 on the tree, 109 60-foot time, 395-202. And as I said, he deep staged. That brings him a little bit closer to the finish line, which will affect the elapsed time. So Brian gets down there and improves 5-9-0-6 up to the number five spot for the former Fuel Altar champion. Dan Horan coasted an 8.93, 95 miles an hour. Will stand on his earlier 5.84 for the number three spot. Folks, that car over there, far side, three-way Chevrolet lane, I would pay particular attention to that car. Both of them looking to race their way into the field. Tyler's gone 6.31.4. Michael Anderson's got 6.4.6.6. Team cars in Top Fuel Eliminator battling it out for an 8-car field. Bobby Hilton standing in front of his kid's car over there, far side. Michael Anderson sport red boots over here on the right side. Two cars try to race their way into the field in Top Fuel Eliminator. Thumbs up to Michael Anderson. Bobby Hilton looking over there. That was a pretty darn good driver himself. Was Tyler's dad, one of the earlier Great Expectation cars. Right. The champ tagged the wall. Holy cow! 6:36:215 for Michael Anderson. That will get him into the, no, I'm sorry, will not get him into the program. But the champ went for a ride down there. She saw that baby about half track start spinning the tires, came over near the center line, went back to the left to scrape the wall. Got one of those Bakersfield stripes. Hey, take a look down there. The reigning national champion is not in the field right now. With one more session this afternoon, scheduled to go off at 3:30. The Bowen family has built some spectacular cars over the years, including this one. Zit number two, that was the 583 at only 205. Of course, Adam Sorokin, 630, 193.
It was a 1,000-foot hit, but it ran a 630. That told us was that we need to throw a lot more at this car. You know, you get a little gun shy when it's cool. You're a little bit worried about spinning the tires and not making a good run out of it. And, you know, now that we're at an 8-car show instead of the 16, you know, it's a battle just to get in to compete. So we'll step on it today, and I have no doubt that it's going to step up. And I think the car will run well.
Here we go. About that 6-2-3, 210. An improvement for the champion car, but still not in the program. Bill Roskowski is from Victoria, British Columbia. And Brad Williamson, that is your defending March meet champion for Mike Fuller and the team. Forever Young finished number two in the world last year. Moving around a little bit down there, Brett Williams said, wow, 6.375 and 2.16. And I know those guys wanted a whole lot more out of that car. Wow, just like that, Top of the Fuel Eliminator. He's rocking and rolling. The tight engineering, A&W Roof here, which, by the way, I had a roof here quote today. Sean Van Horn, the newly licensed Top Fuel driver, three-way Chevrolet lane, and Pete Wittenberg sits number one.
Yeah, this thing's much harder to drive than the Altered. The Altered, I could weave that thing through LA traffic. You know, I could see where I'm going. I knew what was going to happen. And as long as you kept on top of it, it would go. Not being able to see, you look where your eyes go. And it took me a couple of laps and a lot of coaching from Adam Sorokin to tell me where I needed to put my eyes and what I needed to do and just trust that the car will go straight, even though you can't see straight.
Sean Van Horn. Another one of those former Fuel Altered guys moving to Top Fuel. Sean licensed yesterday at a 6:05. So qualifying session number two is qualifying session number one for Sean, as he can now race his Top Fuel Eliminator. And Pete Wittenberg sits number one, two-time March Meet champion, the former national champion. Moving around down there, a cloud of smoke, 6 0-2, 241 miles an hour. We got a little bit of fire down there on Sean Van Horn. Welcome to Top Fuel Eliminator, a cloud of smoke and a ball of fire. Sean was 111, 60-foot time. Sean was 279, 330, 407, 194. But from my vantage point in the tower here, that AW Root Beer Special was moving around down there, and that's why that speed was down to 194 at half track. 602 picking it up to 241 miles an hour. Down there, top end for Sean Van Horn, and a cloud of smoke and a ball of fire, and I will get you the information from the top end on the driver as soon as I can. Dusty Green, a huge Los Angeles Rams football fan. You'll take a look at his helmet there. Of course, Dusty hasn't had much to cheer about this year. Sitting number 16 is Dusty Green. Brandon Murray sitting number 8. He's part of the field, but likes to improve. Wow, Dusty Green. Down there, top end. Brandon is 6-1-5-0, 221. 112 and 60-foot time for Brendan, 280 to 330, 411, 192. Brandon Murray will stay on that number 8 spot, the bump spot, with a 6-10-0. It's the next pair fire up here. Jim Murphy, that aforementioned Jim Murphy, trying to win March Meet number 5, tied the legendary Big Daddy Don Garland for 5 March Meet titles, and Shane Stewart, in from Australia, the Stewart and Sullivan Top Fuel Dragster. Two cars not in the program. Shane Stewart, 674, 135. Interesting little deal. I'd like to talk about the guys in Top Fuel. Shane Stewart, another one of those former Fuel Altered guys. Jim Murphy, crew chief Dan Wilkinson, and the bunch over there, Northern California. Jim Brooks' career has spanned over 60 years. Nitro, Funny Cars, Top Fuel, Dragsters, just a spectacular career, a Hall of Fame career for Jim Murphy in that three-way Chevrolet lane. Shane Stewart moving into Top Fuel would like nothing better to make his mark. The Good Vibrations Motorsports March Meet on Budweiser Michelob Ultra Saturday. Murph is pre-stage. Shane Stewart pre-stage. Oh, look at that Murphy car down there. Both of them lift off the throttle. Jim Murphy, 726, 128. Shane Stewart, 754, 128. And if you could see Murphy's car, that baby looked like a road racer down there. Moving around, and Murphy, the veteran, just hangs on and stays in that number 8 spot at 616-0. Shane stays 14 in an 8-car field.
Yeah, I don't know. The track's okay. I'm not going to blame the racetrack. It was just going. Had a good 60-foot number and just made a quick move, like real quick, and it just got around a little too far and it scuffed the wall. It didn't tear nothing up. So. Chassis wasn't compromised at all. It got into the wing, but they're kind of your mud flaps anyway. So Jeff Manise helped us fix the wing. We put another set of wheels and tires on it, changed the rear end gear, went over everything, checked everything. So it's okay.
As Top Fuel Eliminator, session number 3, to set that 8-car field with Dan Horan Jr., the Patriot Dragster, that three-way Chevrolet lane, and Tyler Hester, your number 3 and number 4 qualifier, Horan being number 3 in 5840. Tyler being number 4 in 5874. Number one, Pete Whitford, 5820. Set the pace at Top Fuel Eliminator. They are pre-staged. They're in. Moran out of the throttle. Tyler Hester out of the throttle. They were both very good on that starting line. Both of them 103 60 foot time. But then by the time we got to 330, Dan Horan was coasted. Tyler Hester was 264.9. Tyler Hester, right on down through there, and will stand on his earlier numbers and stay number four. A Violator Team right side. The national champion, Great Expectations 3. Left side, Bobby Hilton walked back to his boy. Grandma Allison Lee standing in the back of the truck there, trying to get in the field. RPMs up on both cars. Maybe I'll watch the chance hop in. How about your new number one qualifier? Just like that. 5757, 250 miles an hour. And Tyler Hilton goes to the number one spot. Sean Bowen out the throttle, 632.9, 157. And that is top speed of the meet for the Top Fuel Dragsters. The race car builder, fabricator, tuner, Brett Williamson, car owner Mike Fuller, standing out there. They have not put together a solid run this weekend. A 622 and a 637. They also tested tuned on Thursday at that Nitro tested tune and had their issues. So a car that has stumbled, trying to find its way. Still a little ways to get it in the field down there. 6-2-1-1. And that is going to be a DNQ for that Forever Young team. And that is absolutely stunning. Jim Murphy, a four-time Good Vibrations Motorsports March Beat champion and a former national champion, sitting in the number nine spot. He needs to pick up 600 to be part of that field.
I could not have dreamt I'd be doing it this long. It's been great. I've been fortunate, very healthy, and I'm still doing okay at the line, and I'm running the car, and I just love it. It's a passion. I call it my drug of choice, and it's something special. But I never thought I'd be doing it this long. I didn't think I'd live this long.
Crew Chief Dan Wilkinson walks away from a guy who's had a 60-year career championship drag racing, Jim Murphy and the team. Murphy goes in 6-10. How about 594, 242 for Jim Murphy? He will move into the field from the outhouse to the penthouse as Tyler Hester and the team in front of the grandstand, sir. By the way, 594-4 gets him number eight in an eight-car field. But it gives you a place to start. It's Brendan Murray and Dusty Green. Brendan just got bumped out by his buddy, Jim Murphy. Dusty Green trying to get in the field. They're in and set. Brendan, top end, 619.199. Not going to be in that eight-car field. Dusty coasting, 10.05, 69 miles an hour. Dusty started spinning the tires, got in and out the throttle, got her up on a little bit on the side there and said, yep, we'll just coast on down through there at 69 miles an hour. Jim Murphy on the return road, wait to see what happens, because they get in the field, Murphy's going to the trailer. So that'll be interesting. That's a four-time March Beat champion on the return road. wait to see if he has a chance to win number five. That small block Chevrolet in a cloud of smoke, 6.14.0, 200 miles an hour. And Jerm Murphy will be part of Top Fuel Eliminations tomorrow. Starts out that number eight spot, but as we always say, it doesn't make any difference where you start, it's where you finish. And unfortunately, the champion speed shop car is not going to dance on Sunday.
That's just where the oil is, but it was before.
It felt a lot stronger. We did some ignition changes. Thinking that might be the reason why we were so down on power. We had to do a maintenance that was a last minute maintenance. Didn't even get to fire it before we came up. So the fact that it ran at all, I'm pretty excited about. But I had to hold the brake all the way off the starting line to close to just before half track. And then I let go of the brake and it started to charge and it felt pretty good. And then it got to about 1,000 feet and then it was just orange, you know, warm and orange. Unfortunately, I don't think that puts us in, but I think we learned something, so it can't be all that bad, right? There'll be a few more March meets.
Yeah, I mean, it got into the wall enough to get your attention, you know, so we made some changes because of it, and it went right down the racetrack, so it's a lot more rewarding when you go out and go from not even in the field to number one and come back, you got one pinch ring, and you're ready to go, you know, so.
Yeah. It feels good to be number one, and we'll work on this wing and get this fixed properly, and watch out for tomorrow.
It started to move to the left, and when I brought it back to the right, it moved pretty violently, so, you know, instead of getting crazy with it, I decided to click it off and save the car for another day. You know, it doesn't matter what kind of race car it is, you drive with the feeling from your butt, right? So, my advice or my sense of thing is the more different things you can drive, the better, but everything is the feeling in your ass, so any type of race car driving will help. I'm 7,800.
Nice. Track was better than we were, and we rattled the tires, shook hard, had to lift. Second run, when we started the car, it sounded weird. We checked a bunch of things, couldn't quite figure out exactly what it was, took it up to the line, started it, and it had just an unusual drone to the motor. Made the run, no power, didn't get down, you know, a good time. Came back, set the car all up, thought, okay, well, let's go give it for the third chance. Let's hop it up again. We'd soften it up for the second. Let's hop it up for the third one. We made a mistake by softening it. And we thought we'd wait to get the motor some heat so we, you know, we wouldn't cool down before we went to the starting line. Well, gee whiz. We go to start it. Just before we get ready, it won't start. We start checking a bunch of things. We can't figure out exactly what it is. Then we realize the supercharger is not turning in the case. The belt's rotating, but the supercharger rotors weren't turning. It had sheared the cool shaft that goes in the front of the supercharger. It had sheared the 8 bolts that hold it on. So we didn't make the call. We thought the racing gods were going to shine on us, but they held us back a little bit this weekend. But we learned a lot. We didn't tear up any parts. I mean, the motor's really happy. It's one of those things. We'll just have to dust ourselves off, you know, get our act together and regroup and head to Bowling Green and get ready for that.
What keeps you going?
Stubborn. Dumbass, stubborn drag racer. You know, I want to run a small block hard. I want to run it fast. I want to run it hard enough that
the small block guys that are serious come up and go, right on, man, this is what it's about. And I don't know, I sometimes wonder, you know, should I pack it in? But I love it. When it's right, it's the coolest thing in the world. You know, we're racing with friends. You know, it's a little different being on the island. You're very limited to who you can work with. But, you know, I'm racing with friends and we've made it work. So I just gotta hang in there. I just gotta, you know, keep my chin up and move on. But it's a real kick in the nuts.
So, you know, my wife's my backup girl and stuff, and so, you know, I'm watching for her to jump over the guardrail. So whenever you do that, you can kind of see up there, man, and it was like just a wave of people sitting there. I mean, all the way up to whenever we staged up, and then you know, to do the burnout, and then coming, you know, backing up. It's unbelievable to see that many people at this race. Like I said, I just can't thank people enough for coming out here and doing that. Well, you know, one, you know, I'm already in a challenge with this old dump truck motor, so it makes one hell of a situation anyway. But I think just in general, you know, whenever you're dealing with such a volatile fuel and little changes make a lot of stuff happen. Our biggest limiter, I think, right now with this track is, you know, we run on a 12-inch wide tire, and these cars make a lot of horsepower. And it's trying to figure out how you can get down this track on that tire, you know, with a whole lot of horsepower and where the clutch is going to be. And I think yesterday we had some points where, you know, the weather changed 10 or 15 degrees, you know, a little bit of cloud cover came in and then go away. So it's hard to make it happen. You know, you just got to drive the hell out of these cars and hope like hell that it's the best thing that can go on.
It was a difficult racetrack for us all weekend, Les. We smoked the tires or spun the went through the clutch the first and then spun the tires. And so we had to back it up quite a bit. And we were pretty, very, very tickled to get in because it was a last minute hurrah shot there. And we got a tough round the first race, but you never know. We put a little more power in and see if we get on down there and beat Hilton. He'll be tough. He ran really well. But then again, he could smoke the tires this round as he did two runs before the third run that he made.
Well, I think the experience, you back up with what you know and try and be as conservative as possible, because the last thing you want to do is smoke the tires and lose the race or put it away. So we're walking a thin line. So I think the experience certainly helps. We've done a lot of racetracks.
I guess they don't consider them fast, but...
Not by choice. We're kind of a little gun shy from the reunion, you know, after our big fire. So we wanted to start off slow and easy, and it actually worked out to our favor. We got down both sessions fairly good. I clicked it a little early the second session with that 590. Track's tricky at about 60 to 300 feet. Everybody seems to be shaking into smoke. I'm doing a few things there. Not really in the clutch, just kind of with my driving. We got some footage of it. I'm hoping nobody else sees it because I don't want everybody to know what I'm doing. So I'm hoping it works to my favorite first round. We set out Q3, we're having some bearing problems. Some oiling, I don't know what's going on really, so we didn't want to hurt it in Q3 and then have to work all night again. So we think we got it fixed. We stayed up, you know, yesterday and kind of just focused on the car, and we kind of thought, hey, if we get bumped out, we get bumped out. I mean, I went up and watched and I was a little nervous, but we ended up number six. So surprisingly, the Q2 session, we were the second fastest car. I think somebody ran an 87, we ran a 90, which seems weird because it was just slow and it just seemed to go down the track. And then I saw the run sheet and it looked like everybody was having some problems. So I'm happy with that. I think we're in a good spot. I think that might be what it takes to win, just, you know, 590s and make it down, you know. I'm going to try not to overpower, try not to smoke the tires, or just get down there. If I run you know, 580 to 590 and I get beat, so be it. You know, I'm not going to do anything different. I got Bowen next round and he jams and he cuts good lights, so I think I got my work cut out for me.
So a little bit of that stuff that we hate to see in a drag race, but the team is going to continue to work on the track out there, so we'll continue to keep that so we don't lose the track.
Well, it looks like we're going to have to cancel the race, man. Mother Nature got us again. You know, you can't beat Mother Nature. You got to get out there and make it happen. And then all of a sudden, bam, we get another rainstorm. So I guess the higher ups and everybody got together and decided, hey, man, you know, it's better off. We'll just try something different.
Well, and so what is that different? Were they going to make this race up?
Looks like they're going to go to Bowling Green, race it during the qualifier, right?
Or California Hot Rod Reunion.
I mean, they're going to do it at the Hot Rod Reunion.
Yeah, California.
Okay, yeah, they're going to do it at the Hot Rod Reunion. And then, so it's a 2-for-1. Come on out, watch this deal happen, man. You're going to get your money's worth on that deal.